get to it today, which I'll try, but if not, next week for sure, I want to dedicate. But we see the day one of Nisan or Abib, and getting into the times of preparations. And so when we talked last Sunday, the 14th is a day of preparation. That's the day when Christ shared the Last Supper. Amen. Washed the feet of the disciples, went to the Garden of Gethsemane, was arrested, falsely accused, went before his accusers, was beaten. Amen. Went before Pilate, I think, three times that night. Went before Herod once. And was taken out and crucified all on one day. So that's the day of preparation. Remember, the Jewish day starts at 6 p.m. or sunset to 6 p.m. or sunset the following day. So we know that Yeshua had to be off the cross before sunset on the 14th, because the 15th was a high Shabbat, a high Sabbath. It was actually a Moedim, or shall we say, Passover. And then we know Christ was in the ground, grave, 3 days and three nights. So as he was taken off the cross before sunset on the 14th, we go from the 14th to the 15th. And actually on that week Christ was crucified. It was on a Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. So we go from the 14th to the 15th, one day. The 15th to the 16th is one day. The 16th to before sunset on the 17th is the third day he came out of the grave, fulfilling first fruits. And you see the timeline here. And then you see from the 14th going into the 15th, unleavened bread for how many days? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 days, right?
Yep.
And then counting from first fruits to Shavuot was 50 days. So that's where we get Pentecost. All right? So that's basically the timeline of, amen, Passover, unleavened bread, first fruits, and then to Shavuot, which we have come to know today, Pentecost. Hallelujah, Penta. Did you get that? Get a visual of that. Amen. Glory to God. Well, I want to take us, I think I'm just going to share just a few things, and it'll probably take us about 15, 20 minutes, and we'll call it a day. But I want to get this in because I really feel it's very important. Let's turn to the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke. Matthew, Mark, Luke, then John. Hallelujah. Turn to Luke chapter 24, last chapter of Luke. And I want to deal with this now because I want you to see the importance of this and how prophetic and fulfilling it really is. And I'll explain myself in just a minute. Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing. Because from this point out, we're going to look at some very interesting things pertaining to the feast. Last week was a little just teaching and building and establishing some things. Now I get to preach a little bit. Amen. And shift gears. Hallelujah.
All right.
And bring out some things that are really cool. Father, we thank you for this opportunity. We just so appreciate this moment, these moments. We make no excuse for time, people coming and going, but one thing we do is open the Word of God, hallelujah, and feast upon the Lord to taste and see that He is good. And Lord, as we gather around the table of the Lord once again, to break open the Holy Scriptures, to look at Your Word, to gain insight, knowledge, understanding, and wisdom, Father, we want to just thoroughly indulge. Hallelujah, in this process. Reveal yourself to us once again in and through your word and by the power of your Holy Spirit. Open our eyes of understanding that we might all have ears to hear what Ruach HaKodesh has to say to us, first of all, as an individual, corporately today, as the messianic body of Christ, the church. And Lord, we appreciate all that you do for us, for you always have our best interest in your heart and mind. You're setting us up not for failure, but to succeed. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes. And so once again, today, as your bride, we put on a piece of the wedding garment. We prepare ourselves as we go forth, hallelujah, with understanding. Lord, anoint me, anoint your word, anoint our ears to hear, and I just yield myself as your tongue, your mouthpiece, your vessel. In Yeshua's name, we thank you for the anointing upon your word and what we can hear today. In Yeshua's holy name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. In verse 44 of Luke chapter 24, Yeshua, after his resurrection, gave instruction and sound command. Hallelujah. And he said to them in verse 44, "These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of the prophets and Moshe." Hallelujah. The law of Moshe and the prophets, if you will, and the Psalms concerning me. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend then the scriptures. Come on, somebody. Thank goodness for the Holy Ghost. For understanding. Teachable hearts. And then he said to them, "Thus it is written, and thus it was necessary for the Mashiach, the Christ, the anointed one, to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day." And in verse 47, which is key, he said, "Then go forth and preach the gospel," he said, "and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with this dunamis power from on high." So the threefold message unto salvation and conversion is preached right here. Number one, repentance. Number two, remission of sins. He's talking about immersion, water baptism here. Number three, the promise of the Holy Spirit is the sealing and the outpouring. Pentecost. Number three, we must be filled, baptized, sealed with Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. How important is this? Let's turn to Mark chapter, let's see here. Let's turn into Mark chapter 16 and look at verses 15 through 18, if you will. And in closing, I want to look at the timeline that we have here. And I want to look at water baptism and revisit that again before we look at the day of Pentecost and the prophetic fulfillment. Hallelujah, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Then I want to break down and pull out some neat things next week from that for our benefit and welfare. In verse 15, Mark chapter 16, Yeshua said, this is Mark's vision and look, hallelujah. I'm so glad we have the harmony of the Gospels. Amen. And we can see things from a four-sided view, hallelujah.
Yes.
It's layered, if you will. And he said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is immersed," water baptized. Number one, believes. Number two, immersed, baptized, will be saved. But he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. The third element. The Holy Spirit's activity in our life. "And these signs will follow those that believe in my name. They will cast out demons. They will speak with new tongues. They will take up serpents. And if they drink anything deadly, it will by no means hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick, and they shall recover."
Amen.
As we look at water baptism, let's turn to the book of Romans. Chapter 6, Romans chapter 6, verses 1 through 14. Very important that we lay a little foundation before I put a little icing on this cake before we part ways this afternoon now. Hallelujah. Glory. I'm so glad we don't have a clock up in here, but I do like to keep track of time, but I went off and forgot my cell phone today, and that's my watch. Hallelujah. Chapter 6, starting at verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we ask by the Holy Spirit to those who have an ear to hear? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? He says, certainly not, with admonition and rebuke. How shall we who die to sin then live in it any longer? Or do you not know that as many of us as were immersed, baptized into Mashiach, Jesus, the Anointed One, we were baptized into His death, number one. Remember that. Number two, verse 4, therefore we were buried with Him, remember that, through baptism into death, that just as the Mashiach was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, remember that. So we're looking here, hallelujah, death, burial, and being raised, resurrection. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
And verse 4 again, therefore we were buried with Him through baptism into death, that just as Christ the Anointed One was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. Come on, the old man dies, he's dead, behold, all things become new. We are new creations, creatures in Christ. Come on, that's the resurrected life. The dead man is gone, he's dead. Hallelujah. For if we are united together, remember that, in the likeness of His death, certainly we also shall be in the likeness of His resurrection. Knowing this, my friends, that the old man was crucified with Mashiach, and that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. Come on. But eat off the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Eat off the tree of life. Come on. Slap down the flesh. Crucify the flesh. Live the crucified life. That's the only way you can be a true disciple of Mashiach. I didn't say it. He said it. That's His way, not my way. I'm not that intelligent. Come on, somebody. It's a kingdom we live in. We serve a king. What he says goes. We don't get a vote. It's not a democratic society, right? Verse 7. For he who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Mashiach, the Christ, we believe that we shall also live with Him.
Amen.
Knowing in verse 9 that Mashiach, having been raised from the dead, he dies no more. Death no longer has dominion over him. Praise God. He defeated
Amen.
Death, didn't he? Glory, glory.
Amen. Yes.
For the death that he died to sin once and for all. But the life that he lives unto the Father. Likewise, we should come in the same manner. You also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to the Father and Mashiach, Jesus the Messiah, Yeshua HaMashiach, who is Adonai. He is Lord, Lord of lords and King of kings. Verse 12. Therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal bodies.
Yes.
What does that word reign mean?
Rule.
Rule.
Oh.
Alright, don't let it rule. Don't let it reign. Don't let it take seat on the throne. Come on, somebody. Say, help me, Lord, or I'm going to do it. Amen?
Amen.
Likewise, you also reckon yourselves in verse 11 to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, the Lord Adonai. Therefore, do not let sin reign, rule in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. What tree are you eating off of? Hallelujah. And do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness, all your body parts, your members, your eye gates, your ears, your tongue, your hands, your personal organs. Come on, somebody. Don't lend those over to unrighteous acts, yea, unto sin. But present yourselves to Yahweh as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto the glory of our Father. For sin shall not have dominion over you.
That's right.
For you are not under law, but you are under grace.
Glory to God.
Amen.
Isn't the Lord good?
Yeah.
Hold your place there and let's turn to Colossians chapter 2. And let's look at verses 11 through 13. And then we'll put back up the timeline and I want to show you some things about water baptism that you didn't know or realize that I've really never taught on before or brought to light. Because I just learned myself not too long ago.
Amen.
Glory to God. But better late than never.
That's right.
This is a new part of the water baptism teaching. Glory to God. So in verse 11, in him who Mashiach Jesus, you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands by putting off the body. The body of sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, or the Mashiach. You then were buried with him in baptism. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
In which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of the Father who raised him from glory to the dead. And you being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your heart, B.C., he has made alive together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses. But we know that to go down into the waters of immersion, to be fully baptized, hallelujah, deals with remissions of sins as well. Let me see that timeline, brother. The chart, please. Recognize it truly through his death, burial, and resurrection. That's what immersion stands for. So literally, as we make proclamation and give testimony that we are desiring to be immersed into Christ, to surrender our life, to die, if you will, to self, to pick up our cross and follow him, water baptism represents death. Hallelujah. As a human being, the closest thing we can come to the tomb or to the grave is to go down into something that is not natural. You cannot breathe underwater. If you do, you're going to drown. Come on, somebody. You take a breath underwater, you're dead. Anyway, so we hold our breath. Amen. We go down in the water. And we are in the tomb, if you will. We are in the grave, if you will. And then representing, we associate with the resurrection as we come forth out of the water in his name. Hallelujah. And we then begin to live and proclaim the resurrected life. Glory to God.
Amen.
So in water baptism, we associate with his death, burial, and resurrection. As we begin to close, and before we let you go, I want you to look at this timeline because this is, believe it or not, you've never seen it before. But right here, in this timeline, from the 14th actually to Shavuot, is water baptism. Where water baptism fulfills all that right there, that whole timeline.
Oh my.
What are you saying, Pastor Keith? Well, let me give it to you right here. Hallelujah. I believe the Jews fully understood it because for us to get the depths of what God does, we've got to have our Hebraic roots and understanding. Come on. The Bible was written by Jews, for Jews, if you will. Yeshua was a Jew. His disciples were Jewish. Come on. The word was originally written in Hebrew. We have to understand our Hebrew roots, the depth of the Hebrew language, and understand that God, hallelujah, has a rhyme and a reason to us every season.
That's right.
So if we see Christ dying, amen. The Jews fully understood and could embrace, hallelujah, the events that surrounded Christ's death. Christ literally died, right? On Passover. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
We, amen, die in water baptism. Yeshua died during Passover. Come on. The Bible says that he is our Passover lamb.
Yes.
He was crucified for us. His blood was shed for us, right? So Christ died during Passover. He was buried during unleavened bread, the feast of unleavened bread. He was resurrected, amen, in the first fruits. And he sealed us with the Holy Ghost on Shavuot, hallelujah. So literally, through his death, burial, and resurrection, he fulfilled, amen, these feasts and these days. And we hung on until, hallelujah, the 50th day in which we were sealed with the Holy Spirit. The baptism, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Did you get that?
No.
We think lightly of water baptism. Let me tell you, it carries more and more weight the more I look at it and study it. And it is a part of our conversion process. I don't care who wants to excuse it away, and it's not necessary. You don't have to have it. It's not for today. I want to pick and choose what I want and how I want to be converted. This is, amen, the only way to be saved. This is God's righteous requirements unto salvation.
That's right.
How do we know that?
Because Jesus told us so. Jesus showed us the way. So all you got to do is read, and you got it.
He did. So we see that in Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, hallelujah, and then his 40 days upon the earth, and then the 10 days it took, hallelujah, to get to Shavuot or Pentecost, we see salvation, the conversion process. We see water baptism, amen, fulfilling those feasts there in those days. And then the completion of that sealing came on the 50th day of Pentecost. That's awesome.
That's right.
So when we're associating with this death, burial, resurrection, we are actually fulfilling these feast days in and through baptism. That's just one aspect of that. Hallelujah. Which is big and powerful. That just adds more upon what we need to do and how more serious we need to look at that. In absolute closing, I want you to go back to Matthew chapter 3, the Gospel of Matthew. Digest that. Amen. Think about that. It's important and powerful that you get that. And that's another aspect of how important water baptism is. Yeshua was God in the flesh, Emmanuel. Amen. He was all that he proclaimed to be. In Matthew chapter 3, Yeshua had to fulfill the Father's righteous requirements before he could enter into his earthly ministry. Far beyond just example, this is what he needed for himself. It is an example for us to be led by and follow, but guess beyond that, we need it for ourselves as well. In verse 13, chapter 3, then Yeshua came from Galilee to Yochanan, Yohanan, if you will, John the baptizer. He was at the Jordan. What was he doing? He was fulfilling his ministry and call. He was immersing, baptizing. And in verse 14, and John tried to prevent him as Yeshua came unto him, saying, I have need to be immersed by you, Lord, and you are coming to me. And here, underline it, highlight it, put a star by it, memorize it, use it, think about it. This is our motive and reason. But Yeshua answered and said to John, said to him, permit it to be so now. I am coming and submitting to your ministry. We must do this, John. We have to do this. There's no way around it. We don't have any options. Permit it to be so now. Why? For thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness.
Amen.
This is the Father's divine plan. This is His way. Not our way, not religious way, not denomination way, but God the Father's way. And so then John submitted and agreed and allowed him. In verse 16, then Yeshua, as he had been immersed, baptized in water, he came up and immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove and coming down upon him. So here Yeshua is water baptized, immersed. Here Yeshua is filled and anointed with the Holy Spirit. it appears as a dove came down upon him in the form of the Holy Spirit, and his Heavenly Father anointed him. Hallelujah, as King, Priest, Savior, hallelujah, of the world. Glory to God. Empowered him for his ministry. And suddenly a voice came with confirmation, saying from heaven, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased."
Amen.
Father's righteous requirement was activated, fulfilled, submitted to, and obeyed. It brought pleasure to the Father. He stamped his hand of approval upon what just took place. Very equivalent to what we need. If Yeshua needed it to fulfill the righteous requirements of his Father, to even begin his earthly ministry, to be equipped to go the distance, guess what? Who do we think we are that we leave that out? That we bypass it? So we're setting up, hallelujah, Acts chapter 2, and that's where we're going to hit next week. It's very important that we come to understand the fulfilling of Pentecost, Shavuot, in our own life. I'm going to explain that this was also a time of wedding, time of marriage, if you will. The wedding that we are approaching has not been consummated yet, but we are definitely in the betrothal period. You'll see that next week. Amen?
Amen.
So, water baptism is important. Yes. Just more icing on the cake right there to see that play out before us.
Right.
Next week we'll take a look at Pentecost in itself, Shavuot, and the fulfillment of that in the New Testament and how we come under the New Covenant. Amen?
Right.
All right, well, let's close in prayer. We will release you to go. Be a blessing to somebody.